The execute command is fundamentally changing in Minecraft. For the longest time, the execute command in Java and Bedrock were wildly different. Java's made a lot more sense. But as of 1.19.10, Bedrock is getting parity with Java. So if you want to learn Minecraft's most important command in either version, then this video's got you covered. To start, there are four types of execute subcommands. Conditions check to see if a certain condition in the world is met. For instance, I'm using this one kind of like a skulk sensor. The run subcommand allows you to run any other Minecraft command. And when you combine it with conditionals, oh boy, does magic happen. Modify subcommands allow you to change the frame of reference for where your command is executed. And finally, the store type subcommand allows you to take the result of a command and store it somewhere in your world. What the heck does that mean? Watch the video and find out. Today, we are going to start with the
condition
type subcommand, because I have a feeling you're going to be using this one the most. Every conditional type execute command starts the same way, with execute if.
What about execute unless?
I will get to that. It's just not how I wanted to introduce the concept. So the first conditional subcommand we are going to cover is execute if block. All it does is it allows us to check if a certain block is of a certain type. Now, one place I use this in my adventure map is to repair this broken door here. The fuse just blew. So we place glowstone down there. And the command for this is super simple. All you have to do is say execute if block, then you enter in the X, Y, and Z coordinate for that block, and then the type of block that you'd like to check. Now, let's say we wanted the opposite to be true, meaning that when there is no bed, the redstone signal is on. Now, we could just use an inverter in there, that works perfectly well, or we could use the unless version of the subcommand. So coming into here, we now say execute unless block, and this checks the opposite condition. And by the way, unless works with all of the conditional subcommands we are about to cover. And moving on to our very next condition subcommand, execute if blocks. It allows you to compare two different volumes of blocks to see if they are exactly equal block for block. And I used this trick in my roguelike dungeon to make a really interesting pattern puzzle that when players complete it, they exit the room and get a little bit of loot. So you're gonna start with execute if blocks, and then you are going to select one of the corners in your reference area. Then you're gonna head over to the exact opposite corner and select that as well. And now heading over to the area we want to reference, we're going to go to the lowest most northwest block, that's why I have F3 on, and that is going to be the third variable in our command here. Now plugging that into our repeating command block, we notice that the redstone signal is low, and that's because these two sides are currently different. So if we match them up, there our redstone signal goes on. Execute if entity is probably the conditional that I use the most. And we already have an example of that here. This one actually checks to see if a player is within three blocks. And I also use it to detect when players fly through the gates in my flight course. Woo, 41 seconds. And the way this command works is super simple. You just say execute if entity, and then you use a selector that you want to test against. Execute if data is a great way to check if items are in player inventories or in chests. I use this command for magic items on my server, such as the Wand of Midnight, which when held fixes the time to midnight across the whole server. I put together three examples for you here. The first is to check to see if there's an item in the player's inventory, specifically a lightning rod. So we say execute if data entity at the nearest player, and this is the way to check if it's in the player's inventory. And so when I pick up this item, there our redstone signal goes. Moving on to our next example, I wanna see if a player's actually holding the lightning rod. So the way to do that is to say selected item is the lightning rod. The rest of the command is the same. So when I select the lightning rod, there our redstone signal goes high. Finally, if we wanna check if the lightning rod is within a chest, then all we do is we say execute if data block. We set the block where the chest is located. We say items is lightning rod somewhere in the chest, doesn't matter where it is. And then all I do is I drop this bad boy in, and there our signal goes on. Execute if score is a great way to reward players for doing well in your minigames. For instance, I keep track of the number of consecutive rooms that players have completed in my roguelike dungeon. And ooh, I got a decent pair of boots? Every 5 rooms, players are granted some kind of reward. And while scoreboards are technically out of the scope of this tutorial, it's kind of important to understand them because that's how Execute If Score works. So whenever players complete one of the rooms, we add 1 to the Vilethorn Dungeon Room Count scoreboard. And the way the command works for that is we say Execute If Score that matches the number 5. And we notice here that this isn't on because I believe my score is 35 right now. So if we change this over to 35, there that goes, it is now on. And you can also check to see if the score is greater than or less than, which makes this command super flexible. Execute if predicate is like if you took execute if data, execute if score, and execute if entity, and combine them all into a super efficient selector. Now, if it's super efficient, why don't we just use it all the time? Well, that's because it requires you to create a data pack. And here inside of a predicate that I made, I check to see if a player is in the overworld and between 610 and 8,000 blocks from wherever this predicate is run. I've also linked a predicate generator in the description of this video in case you want to make your own. Now, in order to test the predicate we made in our data pack, we run execute if predicate, and then we drop in the name of the predicate we gave in our data pack. We hit done, and for some reason, our redstone signal is low. In order to fix this, we need to get a little further into the tutorial. The run type subcommand is about as simple as it gets. See, you type execute run, and then you follow that up with the Minecraft command that you want to run. Now, you're probably wondering what the heck the point of that is. Well, you can chain conditional and modify commands into run commands. So for instance, we could check to see if this block right here is a gold block, and that test, unsurprisingly, has passed. Now, if we precede our particle command with that check, that'll mean that particles are only going to show up if this block is a gold block. You can AND together as many conditionals as you want up to the character limit. For instance, if I only wanted this water to flow when the block on the left was gold and the block on the right was red wool, I could make the command something like this. That's how I figure out when to drop this giant gate when these two diamond blocks are destroyed. Yee-hee! With the run command and command chaining mastered, we now need to talk about
modify
type subcommands. And honestly, modify subcommands are super simple because they just change the reference frame of the command, meaning where it's run in the world and who ran that command. A common problem I have is with NPC dialogue. You see, when players approach the knowledge bearer, he's going to say,
"You are in a place of great knowledge.
Blah, 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 blah." The thing is about this pressure plate, it's a complete lie. This isn't attached to anything. If we head down to the not as pretty depths of this tower, we see a command block monstrosity that actually controls all of the villager dialogue. And one way to solve my problem is to execute all of the commands down here to the position that they should run up above. And what this does is it dramatically simplifies the commands that follow them. And it makes things a heck of a lot cleaner for us. And that covers execute position. Execute at is nearly identical, but a lot more powerful. A good example of this is in my evil AI boss fight, where this guy, of course, is trying to kill me. And the way that he does this, or one of many ways, is he creates these particle walls that when I touch them, I am completely vaporized. There are these armor stands that are sliding along tracks just beneath the stage. And what I'm doing is I'm summoning particles at those armor stands using the execute at command. A simpler example is if we try to summon particles around this sheep here. The way we do that is we type execute at, and then we can select any entity within a distance of 10 blocks. And by chaining on a particle command and clicking done, we now have a beautiful glowing sheep underbelly. And since players are entities, I also get this really cool particle effect under my feet. Execute aligned allows you to push your command to one of the edges of a block. For instance, if I type align X, the particles are now shown up on the X axis of the block. And you can even specify all 3 axes to push the command to the corner of a block. I have never used this. Execute rotated allows you to change the rotational frame of reference. Channeling the Legend of Zelda here, I kind of picture a little particle wisp that follows the player wherever they go. Right now, I have it so that the rotated parameter is always 180 degrees relative to where the player is facing. But if I set this to 0 degrees, then Navi can come and talk to me. Hey, listen! Execute facing works nearly identically, except you can point applied to blocks or entities in your world. And the whole command looks something like this. Execute anchored allows you to run a command from a player's eyes or from a player's feet. I never use this. Execute in is the only way you can teleport players between dimensions. So when I say execute in the end and teleport Avid to 090, we're gonna head on over to the end dimension. And the last modify subcommand is execute as. If you guys didn't know, I like to make cutscenes. Ohm, the old one, he made me do it. Everyone, get out of here now! What, I didn't say they were good cutscenes. And a common problem I have in these cutscenes is I want to nudge my actors a little bit in one direction or another. So let's say we have two sheep here and we want to nudge both of them to the left. We could do something like execute at, select the sheep, then run teleport at all of the sheep. Command looks something like that. But there's a problem with this, because when you run it, the sheep consolidate to a single square. The way to fix that is we change execute at to execute as, we use at s, and we also change the teleport to at s. And voila, we now have synchronized sheep. And with all of the modify subcommands mastered, we can now fix our predicate. The way we do that is we say execute as all players on the server positioned at the spawn point, and now our predicate works perfectly. And that means we are ready for execute store, which allows you to take the result of any of the commands we just talked about and store that into the NBT data of a block, boss bar, entity, score, or storage.
I don't use this one.
But for the integrity of this video, we have to at least try one. So let's make a boss bar. Just gonna do some quick research here. Yes, I see. So according to this book, all I have to do is summon in a boss and then create a boss bar. Then the magic comes in with the execute store command. We store the result into the custom boss bar that we made, and we store the entity's health into that boss bar. And then all I should have to do is hit this button. This is the end of the line, sheep. That's all you have to say to me after all these years. Your reign of terror ends today. Goodbye, old friend. Goodbye. Why? That was so stupid. For the three of you who made it to the end of this video, you should consider subscribing, and I highly recommend you check out my adventure map series. Also, if you want to learn more about the execute store command, I'll leave a link in the video, and I'll see you all next time. Bye-bye.